Welcome to Park City, Utah, the home of the 2002 Winter Olympic Games. We are in the second Viessmann World Cup bobsleigh and skeleton weekend of the season, getting ready for the deciding run in the second women's race of the year. And we've got a fascinating race in prospect after some really exciting action in the women's skeleton and the two-man bobsleigh race. It looks as though the women will not disappoint the fans either. Let's take a look at the first heat. Top four, very close indeed. I'm Martin Haven alongside me, man who won gold in the two-man race, Kurt Tomasevich. And Kurt, this looks like it might be just as tough to call. You've got Austria's Christina Hengster looking really strong in fourth.
Yeah, there could be a couple variables in this second heat because it was snowing really lightly when Christina Hengster went the first time and a couple of the other competitors. It was snowing really light, but now it seems to be clearing up a little bit. So it'll be really interesting to see how Alana Myers, see if she can move up a little bit and catch Sandra and Kaylee as well.
Fastest start in the competition for Alana and Aja Evans. 5.10 seconds, they shatter the existing track record. Well, all you need to do is tidy up one tiny error, Kurt, and suddenly you found another 10 somewhere. What about Sandra Kyriassis? Lots of wins in her history on this track already.
Yeah, Sandra is known on the tour as probably the best driver in the back of a bobsled, or excuse me, in the front of a bobsled. You know, she knows how to get the sled down, not just safe, but incredibly fast.
But she's going to have to beat the woman who is on a streak at the moment. Three race wins in World Cup action consecutively for Kaylee Humphries, including last weekend with rookie breakwoman Chelsea Valois. They are in the lead again going into the deciding heat here. She's looking for four in a row. History is against her. The last 9 World Cup races have been won only by the USA or Germany. USA 3, Germany 6 is the score there, but the Canadians don't like to pay much attention to what happened before. So there is your top 10 ranking. All 16 sleds will go, starting with Ekaterina Kostyumina of Russia. Well, that means that we have got plenty of sliding still to complete what's been a busy day at the track here at Park City for the fans. Ice minus 3, air temperature. Well, it was high as 7 or 8 degrees during your race. It's really dropping now with the sun.
Yeah, the sun goes down behind the mountains, and it cools down pretty quickly here.
Jasmine Fenlater and Katie Ebeling with her teammates warming up there. There's Coach Tom Delahunty, Kaylee Humphries with the Movember Tash, and her breakwoman Chelsea Valois. They'll go last. And Kurt, of course, this is all a vital part. When you come off the bottom of the track, you go back up on the truck to the top, you get the sled ready, but you've got to get your body ready as well to produce the goods again.
Yeah, definitely. You know, there's a lot of time in between the first and the second heat sometimes, and it's you almost have to take the same approach for both heats as far as your warm-up approach and really just getting your body ready.
Well, the medalist on the top step of the podium earlier on this afternoon joins us in the booth to try and make some sense out of this, but it is going to be very close because we've got half a dozen sleds covered by less than a couple of tenths of a second in the middle of the top 10, so expect to see some changes. Well, like the men's sled, the women's sled fits the same dimensions. It's marginally lower all-up weight to take account of the fact that the crews are lighter. The basic sled itself weighs the same whether you're 6'6", 235 pounds, or 5'5", and 135 pounds. So as Kurt was saying earlier, pro rata, the women actually have to work a little bit harder. I'm not sure you get too many male bobsledders agreeing with you on that one, though.
Yeah, the sled spec that wasn't shown there is that the minimum weight of the sled is 170 kilograms, men or women.
And it is now rapidly starting to stick to the ice with the sub-zero temperatures. To kick us off, Ekaterina Kostyumina and Anna Pumotova. The distinctive baritone of Russian coach Malcolm Gomoloid bellowing from the top of the track. Now they started 5.53, 5.55. Kurt, as the temperature drops, there's a bit of moisture in the air. It's a little frosty at the top, like your ice box. You know, things stick to the ice.
Yeah, there's a lot of variables that play into this. I said the ice is, or the temperature is dropping a little bit. That can cause the ice to be a little sticky. At the same time, all the sleds that have gone down before this one can cause the ice to deteriorate a little bit. The ice is a little harder with the colder temperature, which sometimes speeds up the track. So you really don't know until you see the first few sleds go down the hill.
Long slide will have cost her a tenth of a second at least. The first week on the ice here, and yikes, a out of Albert's alley safely, but only just. 124.8, 77 miles an hour onto that final straightaway for a 50.91 slide, tenth of a second slower than her first heat, and that big skid will certainly have added to that time.
Yeah, she's a new driver, making a few mistakes as she goes down the course. You know, a tenth of a second difference between runs, that doesn't necessarily mean that the track is slower. You just can't rely on consistency from a rookie driver. See, so yeah, she slides from curve 9 into curve 10, the bottom part of that labyrinth. Takes a little early into 10, and her exit out of 10 into a straightaway breaks into a pretty hard skid. You can see her, the runner tips in the front, really trying to correct that, but it's too late by that moment.
Gets into the rough ice, bumps off the wall, and of course, all of these things slow you down. Next up, Russia 1, Olga Stulneva, or Olga Fedorova, as she was known up until her marriage during the summer. Silver medalist in the Athens Games in a 4x100-meter relay. She's got speed over the ice, but doesn't seem to be able to translate that into power at the start.
Yeah, you would think with such a fast break, they'd be able to have faster starts. A 5:35 start, you know, that's just, you know, it's hard to tell so far if this start is speeding up from the first heat, but, you know, their start was a rank of 11 in the first heat. You would expect that to be a little quicker.
I'm sure when you came into the sport, Kurt, same as me, you always looked to the Russians for starts because that was their, you know, forte. Above all else, they would always outstart everybody else and try and work on the rest. And it seems that they're looking at it a different way around because they haven't got quick starts.
Pretty quick coming out of curve 10 into 11, hit that pretty straight.
She's 44 hundredths up on her teammate, so she's already doubled her first round advantage and extending that. 125 kilometers now, just a fraction quicker all the way down.
If you remember that first heat, she hit that luge entrance, and that really sent her way back in the rankings. So, you know, she avoided that mistake this time, so there's a really good chance that she'll be able to move up in the rankings.
Yeah, she's got a couple of tenths behind Astrid Radjenovic of Australia, who's the next sled, so she will be looking to pull off that scalp.
Coming through curve 12, the Olympic corner, and into curve 13. Excuse me, coming out of 14 here.
Good straight run down towards the finish line. Little happier, well, let's say a little less unhappy with that, perhaps, than the first run. Astrid Radjenovic, Astrid Lot Wilkinson, as was, married to Vuk Radjenovic, who slides for Serbia. Spends half her time in Australia, the other half in Europe. And Fiona Harrison from Great Britain. She's from Yorkshire, former brakewoman and pilot in GB bobsleds, now sliding on the back of the Australian sled with Astrid. Well, this is a team that's only been together literally for a handful of weeks. And Kurt, you know all too well as a brakeman, it does take time to get a rhythm and get that partnership working.
Yeah, definitely. You know, we're teammates, we're training partners and all kinds of things that help build confidence, help build this relationship of trust. You know, as two people go down to the sled, you know, it's a very dangerous sport, so you do have to put an element of trust into it.
5:40, fraction quicker than their first getaway. See what speed they carry. Anything north of 84 is good, 84 kilometers an hour.
You can really hear this sled rattling as it comes down. You know, it's a BT sled, and you would expect it to be pretty quick and aerodynamic, but, you know, sometimes some things in there get a little loose and rattle and make different noises.
130.1 kilometers an hour, as fast as the Russians. Of course, she's mechanic, travel agent, sponsor, physiotherapist, coach, and driver for the team. So she's covered a lot of bases. Ooh, little tap down the straight would have cost a time.
Yeah, that's really hard making those taps as you're coming uphill into curve 15. You can see that she lost a little bit of time going from 14 hundredths of a second back to only 4 hundredths of a second ahead. But at the same time, that's not where you want to make mistakes, is going uphill.
Thumbs up from René Spies and Matthias Höpfner, the German coaches who are helping down at the bottom.
See, a little hard transition as she comes out of this curve, slams the back end of the sled down just a little bit.
You're looking at the entire Aussie team. They're not true, strictly speaking. They have an alternate brake woman with them, but that is a team of three. They've already deposed two of the three Russian sleds, and think of the size of their operation. So she's not going to finish on the podium, but she is certainly punching well above her weight. Now, 13th spot, just a couple of hundreds quicker than the Aussies. Again, Jennifer Cecchetti, brand new driver, started behind the D-rings last season, returned to break Kaylee Humphries to World Championship glory in Lake Placid in February, and now is really embarking on her first season as a driver. There's Astrid on the left, Fiona on the right.
Jennifer chooses to wear the goggles that her former coach Pierre Luters always wore. A little different than most drivers that wear a visor. A lot of people think that the visor is more aerodynamic, but I don't think it makes a huge difference. Just barely misses that luge entrance into curve four that we saw the Russians and the Swiss team hit earlier.
She was having a real wobble around off corner three, maybe just got a little too high up on for the speed that she was carrying. 29.8. Now, nobody's been under 130 so far, so Jen is losing speed.
1/13 of a second ahead right now, but again, slower speed. We'll see if she can have it. Hold on to that type of lead. Now down to a 10th.
This could be close. If she's mistake-free down the straightaway, she could be there. That's a good run. 125.1. That's good speed. Could just keep her nose in front. Does just keep her nose in front. 50.59 slide.
Yeah, pretty decent. You know, Jennifer's done the America's Cups on this circuit or on this track before, but this is her first World Cup on this track.
Again, it's all about time on the ice, the experience here, isn't it? You know, for the driver, it's a very limited time at all.
You can see curve two already. She's back into the sled, swings out just a little bit as she comes at the exit of two, and she takes that tap on the right side. It makes it difficult to set up curve three, and as I mentioned, she just barely misses that left wall. The luge entrance joins the track.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad.
Yeah, a little different look, I think, from anything Mom and Dad have ever seen their daughter sporting, I'm hoping.
I'm not sure Mom and Dad would be proud of that one.
Well, luckily it'll rub off. Anastasia Tambovseva of Russia. Now, she is the remaining of the third Russian sleds. She's only in 12th position. She's the best placed. The great woman, Margarita Ishmaelova.
Justin Cripps' website, Canada 3.
Go and support the guys and girls supporting Movember. Now, the top Russian sled in heat one, just 0.04 of a second in front of the Aussies, who currently lie second. So there is definite potential here for change. Very upright push style from Tambovseva. Staggers a little getting in.
You know, again, I mentioned this track is a little bit different because the driver has to really load into the sled quickly and grab the D-rings because, as a in contrast to Lake Placid where we were last week, that first curve comes up pretty quick. The driver has to be able to control the sled in curve number one.
She had decent momentum, but nothing that you'd particularly want to flag up. 130.3, still in the ballpark, but Kurt, she's behind, and it's a long way to come back from there.
Yeah, she's a 10th of a second back right now, and I don't think she has the speed to make that comeback.
A couple of good lines here. She's still the 10th back. A little hard onto Olympic curve. Let's have a look at 14. 25.1, not fast enough, surely. No, not enough at all. So, staying in the lead, Jennifer Cecchetti. She does slip into second ahead of the Aussies. Well, Russia salvaged something. They weren't all beaten by Australian sled.
Yeah, it's pretty upsetting knowing that the Russians are pouring in so much money and so much effort into their effort looking toward the Sochi Olympics in 2014, but it's just not working right now.
Well, no. Oh, dear. Didn't see that in real time. That was an ugly slide right
back into the sled, skids up. You know, she did have decent speed after curve six, but here between 10 and 11, see that sled just kind of skidding sideways.
Anastasia Tambovseva lies in second. It is Canada and Jennifer Cecchetti that are leading. Now, here's really a major surprise. Anja Schneider-Heinz only 11th after first heat, more than 3/4 of a second off the lead.
I'm not sure how much she can come back from this, but I will give her some benefit of the doubt. She was the first sled off the hill, and there was a light snow, so she might have been kind of the snowplow for the rest of the field, but you know, we'll be able to tell that on the second heat here.
I'll tell you something that is informative. Only 6 quickest start from Schneider-Heinze, and that is not what you expect. 5:28 first heat, 5:29 in the second.
Yeah, typically she's in the top three with that push start rank.
And a little wavy through two and three, just avoided that luge in run on corner four. 130.4. Well, that's the fastest speed we've seen so far.
The one thing she does have to her advantage is that German equipment. You know, the Germans put a lot of effort and money into their equipment. They're always, you know, walking to the line confident that they have really high, kind of a double wave as she comes through 14, and that results in that skid as she comes uphill. But 33 hundredths of a second lead, she should be able to hold a lot of that. 38 hundredths, yep.
Well, that's a much better looking slide. It was over a tenth of a second, 14 hundredths quicker than her first effort. But still, Kurt, you know, lack of time for her on this track is really telling. She's only been here two, maybe three times in her entire career as a driver. And so, yeah, it's finding the touch.
Yeah, here you can see the start, the brakeman's head, wow, it's really bobbing back and forth. You want to use a lot of that energy and just go straight ahead. That's kind of wasted energy we like to talk about. Coming out of curve 14, you can see that skid sideways. She was able to straighten it just a little bit as she comes up to the uphill portion. But Christoph Langen doesn't seem to be too happy or displeased.
The German bobsledding, i.e. Christoph Langen's watch, scored a fat total of zero medals in Lake Placid last week. It was only the skeleton girls that managed to save their blushes. Henry Schneider-Heinz leads. Still 10 sleds to come here at the Utah Olympic Park. Stay with us.
Approximately 7-8, sometimes 9 days to prepare the ice, start building the ice. It's all done by hand. Kick it off mid-October. Spring water.
Shaping the ice by hand. The entire track is built and maintained by hand. So thumbs up. Congratulations. For Seth Fisher for banging it out there.
Tomorrow's his last day. Great job there, Seth, leaving us.
Hey kids, hey everybody, welcome back to Utah Olympic Park, just outside Park City in the Mormon state. We are in the Wasatch Mountains and we are deep in the second heat of the second World Cup race of the women's bobsleigh season. Anja Schneider-Heinz, you saw her there with her taped up brake woman, Lisette Turner. They lie in the lead with 10 sleds remaining. Martin Haven alongside me. Gold medal winner this afternoon, Kurt Tomasevich in the USA one sled. And Kurt, Fabian Meyer, this not really a track that plays too much to the Swiss girl's strengths. She hasn't got the fastest start, and that's certainly something that you need to produce here.
Yeah, you're right. She needs to improve her start time, but she made just a huge mistake coming out of curve three into curve four, hit that luge entrance. And if she can avoid that, she has a good chance of moving up the ranks.
5:43 getaway, that's really not helping her. It's here off corner two and three. She's got to get the line right. Stay right. She stays right.
Almost too far right. A little early going into four.
Well, you know, when you've had a big hit like that, you will go twice as hard to avoid it. 1/12 of a second up on Schneiderheinzer. That's a big reduction of her first round advantage of 2,800, and there goes a 10th.
Cause a little bit of a skid. You know, she's really looking forward to the World Championships. They're going to be in St. Moritz, Switzerland, her home track. So even though she's not having the greatest of date right now, she's really got something to look forward to.
It'll be a track like this, a track like Eagles, a track like Calgary, that she'll really just have to survive and hope to do better on a driver's track. 50.47. She stays in the lead by just 0.06 of a second.
And even with that huge mistake she made in the first heat, she still finishes ahead of Schneiderheinz, a German sled, and that's saying something at least.
Yeah, definitely. You can see brake woman's left leg taped up, Anja Bitzer, and I wonder about Anja Schneiderheinz. She looks okay.
A little bit of a skid coming through the final two curves.
Schneiderheinz had great speed, just took rather a long while to get there. Schneiderheinz has sliced the advantage to the Swiss girls, but they are our leaders with 9 to go. Now, she was around half second off the lead. The next sled was 1,200s closer. This is Esme Campus of the Netherlands with Judith Viss behind her. Coaching the Black Hat, women's bobsleigh world champion Nikki Minicello.
Now you can see the brake person's first few steps, those footsteps in the back. It seemed like her first couple steps were a little bit short. You know, you want to be able to drive the sled and take some really long strides and have a nice high knee drive, but first few footsteps seemed a little short. That kind of reflected the start time. Not an awesome start time.
5:31 is the start for Dr. Esme Campus and Judith Viss, her brake woman. 2,800s up now on race leader Fabienne Meyer of Switzerland. So doubled her first round advantage now out to 3,300s. This is a nice looking run. So then we had John Montgomery in the booth earlier. He said a year away from the ice last year allowed him to recharge the batteries physically and mentally. And do you know what? That might be working for Esme as well. She's putting together a really nice run.
Yeah, if you're just looking at that run she just had in this second heat, you know, taking a year or two off, that really seemed to help her focus. That was a fantastic run.
50.11 was what Fabienne Meyer managed in the first heat, but nobody else has got close. That's a really tidy second heat. Well, way high there.
Yeah, we missed that in lifetime, but that high exit coming out of eight into 9 and into 10 set her up for that labyrinth, but pretty good speed coming out of curve 6.
And she got a great exit as well. She was late in the middle of Albert's Alley and yet exited right on the line. So they're pretty happy with that, and they might well pull themselves a little further up the order. Another step up though, Jasmine Fenlater and Emily Azevedo, the USA one sled, lying in 8th position. Third fastest start, so that tells you what you need to know about where Jasmine's focus will be now, trying to tidy up the first round errors.
Jasmine raced with Lolo Jones last week. They had a pretty good start time here with Emily Azevedo. 5:29 start time, the best we've seen so far in the second heat. They had the third fastest in the first heat. Jasmine made one mistake coming out of curve 10, and it was in a big skid, and that probably caused her to be a little bit back. A little skid going into 4 there, not the best line.
A little deep into 4. Down into Albert's Alley now. Let's see if she can carry some speed here. 1,400s up on the Dutch. 1:31 is good speed as well.
1,300s to 1,400s. That's where she had the mistake in the first heat, but seemed to correct most of that in the second heat.
It's a good exit. Ooh, gap's coming down. She's still leading, but not by a lot. Needs a good straight. Doesn't get a good straight. 1,200s up. Could be down to 400 or 500s. No, hangs on to that speed.
50:13 downtime. Not too bad. Again, you know, a couple driving mistakes, nothing really major, but all those things, little insignificant things you would think, but they certainly add up.
5:29 start, 50:13 downtime. That's what's being relayed by Coach Mike Kahn.
Emily really technically sound pushing from the brakes. We mentioned with the Dutch team that they took some choppy steps, but Emily really drives her legs really far. Little skid going into curve four, and this is at the top end of the track where it can kill a lot of speed, and she ends up going pretty high in the entrance there.
Speed at the bottom, Anja Schneider-Heinz is still stopping the clocks, 127.2 kilometers an hour, the fastest sled down there. Jasmine Fenlater moves into the lead, but with seven still to come, medal is going to take a lot of assistance from those remaining to try out the ice. Next up, Great Britain's Paula Walker, only 100th in front of Jasmine after the first heat, but just a couple of sleds in front of her, tied for fifth, 200s quicker as well. So again, we're in one of those little groups where you could see a lot of changes.
Yeah, Jasmine was in the back of that group, but she could move up. Paula could definitely move up as well.
Let's see what start the junior world champion can produce with Jill Cook behind her. Two hits are getting into the sled. 5:26 ties their first getaway to the 100th.
A little bit quicker than Jasmine's start time in the second heat.
Nice. Ooh. Three, but hits the wall in four.
That is about the most crucial mistake you can make in this track, is hitting that luge entrance, you know, because it's angled into the track. And so when you hit that, you're hitting at an angle that it almost brings you to a stop, it feels like.
129.4 to 131 at Jasmine Fenlater. No wonder she is hemorrhaging time. Now she's trying to let the sled fly and make it up, but it is not working. 1800s back. Hoping to make up places. It's going the other way for her, same as John Jackson in the two-man race. 50.38 slide. Jasmine stays in the lead with Emily Acevedo. Maybe the fourth best slide, but a long way slower than Jasmine and Esme Campos, quarter of a second off their pace.
Yeah, just that huge mistake between curves three and four. That's, the rest of it is history, I guess. Little slide out of two. Seems to be coming out pretty smooth out of three, but drifting left and hits the front bunk and the left bunk, front bunk and the rear bunk on the left side into that lose entrance.
Goodness me, says Coach Pete Gunn. Yeah, that. In fact, she's the second girl who's hit the wood upstream of the actual fillet in from the lose track. So hitting it really early and then hitting the short wall as well. Next up, Kathleen Martini. She's about to ruin one of the stats that Infostrada, our friends, the statisticians, have come up with, that last three women's bobsleigh races in Park City in the World Cup have been won by Germany 2. That was Sandra Martini and Sandra Kyriassis. Kathleen Martini and Sandra Kyriassis. Kathleen is Germany 2, but from fifth, she's going to win this. Tell me she's not.
It's going to be tough.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a pretty big jump. You know, maybe she can get the fourth, third place even, but all the way to the top to catch Kaylee Humphreys, that's going to be really difficult.
5:33 getaway, 5:31 in the first heat.
A little bit of a skid there between two and three, but pretty good entrance into curve four. Haven't seen that in a while.
Yeah, this is where you really start to accelerate, doing 50 miles an hour in curve four, being 75 miles an hour in curve six. 131.1 kilometers now, 81.5. That is the fastest we've seen.
Yeah, even though she's behind at the top, she's driving really well, also known as one of the best drivers on the tour, and now she's 500s ahead. That was pretty much expected.
Wow. Now she needs to start motoring away. She's only 300s quicker than Jasmine Fenlater in USA 1 after the first heat. Opens that up by a further 1500s. Jawohl, a little bit better from Christoph Langer. Kathleen Martini as well. Yeah, she's much happier with that drive. And of course, for Kathleen, for Sandra, and particularly for Anja Schneider-Heinzer, this is like when you go to Winterberg, like when you go to Koenigsee, you're in somebody else's backyard where they grew up sliding.
Yeah, that's true. The North Americans definitely have an advantage being on this track so many times. But this isn't necessarily a driver's track where, you know, a driver can really make up time. But Kathleen seemed to do about as good a job as possible in driving from a slower start.
She had top speed all the way down the track. Not off a great start, as you say. With both speed traps, she outpaced everybody else. So Stephanie Schneider and driver Kathleen Martini lead. Tied off the first heat were Germany 2 and USA 3. This is Jamie Grubel with Katie Eberling. Let's see what they can produce in the USA 3 sled. A medal here would really help them in their North American tour.
Jamie had to take a year off because of an ACL injury last year. And I was only able to do some of the America's Cup circuits and wasn't able to compete full time. But a little hiccup getting into the sled there. Not too bad. 5:25 start time. That's pretty good.
That ties their first heat. Third quickest time.
But both Jamie and Katie, great athletes. So that 5:25 start time is a reflection of that.
4.5 again, tying nearly the fastest speed.
Now, if you listen really closely, this is one of those sleds where you can kind of hear a whistle as it goes by. Sometimes with Bodine sleds will do that.
131.4, fastest through the speed gun.
Jamie made a little mistake out of between curve 4 and 5, but really driving well. 700ths of a second ahead right now.
Gap's coming down, though. She needs a good straight. Way slow, 126.6, not enough, surely. No, 50.05. Kathleen Martini did mine for gold down at the bottom of the track. She found speed. Whether she'll find a medal remains to be seen. USA 3, Jamie Grubel and Katie Eberling in second spot with four to go. So top six finishes. This is all the sort of stuff that Olympic selectors like to see.
You know, once again, they had a pretty good start time. A 5:25, 5:25 start time is really good. Jamie gets caught up just a little bit getting into the sled, not as smooth as you would like. But for the most part, she has some really good lines going down the track.
Finish in front of USA2's Jasmine Fenlater. But you know, the number here reflects how you did in the trials. The teams are within a whisker being interchangeable, aren't they?
Yeah, the German team, the American team, even the Russian team. You know, even though they were farther back, but the three of them are pretty equal. The Americans and the Germans are pretty equal higher up in the ranks, you know, pretty competitive toward the medals.
Still waiting her turn, Alana Myers. First up, though, Christina Hengster and Inge Wess and the Austrians. Fourth after the first heat, 300ths of a second from a medal. Well, this will be a big day again for the Austrian program. If they can take a World Cup medal in North America at one of the less used US tracks as well. 5:39 getaway again, same as their first heat.
But Christina really drove the sled well in the first heat. They drove from a rank of 13 at the start to a rank of 4 at the bottom. That's doing some pretty good magic.
Well, she's already finding the speed. She's got the same momentum at the first clock that Jamie Grubel had off a start 1,400 slower.
130.8 kilometers per hour. Lead is now 1/100th of a second.
This is going to yo-yo in and out of the green and in and out of the red, isn't it? One good corner, she's up. One bad corner, she's back. Good straight, little tag on the wall. A fraction quicker, but not enough to get in, surely. No, drops to fourth.
Yeah, that's one of our slower speeds we saw coming out of curve 14 and into 15.
That medal hope has just evaporated, slipped away from her below Albert's Alley. Wow, now then, that opens up the opportunity. Kathleen Martini can't win this, right? She's with three to go.
It would be tough. You'd be proving us wrong.
The statisticians would love it.
Pretty good lines coming through the labyrinth down into out of 10 into the 11th, but see her hit on the right side of her sled. That might have been one of the reasons why she just didn't have the speed coming out of curve 14 and uphill into 15.
Even though it was a tiny touch on the wall, she spent a couple of seconds on that choppy ice. The runner's getting bumped around and held up. Well, disappointment for her. Let's see now. We have three to go. Now we're into the serious business. Germany, USA, USA, and three sleds still remaining. Can the German girls get a medal here this season? They've got two shots at it. First up, though, Alana Myers.
Regardless how this race turns out, I'm excited to see this start time here. You know, they had a 5:10 in the first heat, which probably would have beat some of the men today. 5:13 in this second heat, not quite as fast, but still, that's saying something with a 5:13 start.
That's inside the old track record. She busted a partner, and she hits the wall again before the luge in run and after it.
It's tough to just keep that speed, you know, now you're just trying to stay alive.
4 tenths up on Kathleen Martini, that is still a massive margin. There was only 700s between them from the first heat. 3 tenths up now on Martini. Can she keep the speed alive?
It would take a pretty devastating mistake for her not to keep this lead. Oh, but only 800ths of a second.
So much speed went in corner four. Has she got enough? No, she's behind. And that
really
was
slow
awful
speed.
Run. 1:23. She's going to go third, fourth, sixth.
Wow.
Oh my lord, 50.40 slide for Ilana Myers. The horror story started in turn four, and that, I'm afraid, just took the wind out of her sails. Kathleen cannot quite believe what's going on here. She is in the medals.
Yeah, I mean, this was the best part of the trip, you know, obviously, with the 5:13 start. Asia really powering that sled hard. They get into the sled nice and early and quick. But just too many mistakes.
Here.
This was probably one of the biggest mistakes. Hits the, well, actually she just misses, but she was in a big skid there.
Again, she hit the woodwork before where the loose track comes in, the protection there for the loose track to stop you really hitting the short wall.
That might actually have been a blessing to hit that before the luge entrance.
Yeah, otherwise she'd have really stacked it. Wow. Kathleen Martini leads for Germany. Two to go. Sandra Kyriassis and Franziska Bertels, 900ths off the lead in the first heat.
What a race, yeah.
Yeah, right, really, that's the lucky penny. All right, now we know the secrets.
And Kathleen was 1,300ths of a second behind Sandra after the first run. So, you know, Kathleen's in that leader's box right now, but every sled that comes down, she's in a hole deeper and deeper.
But 1,300ths, Kurt, we've seen you lose that in one corner here. Surely not, Sandra.
Now she's probably going to be in the red after the first few curves because her start time is not that great.
Well, she and Kathleen Martini started identically in the first heat, 5:31s. She starts at 5:32. Martini was 33. Does she get three right? Skid into the wall! Wow.
Just missed it. That's
got
something
away with
Sandra
that.
Can do. You know, she can put that sled almost anywhere she wants to. Now her lead is 20 hundredths of a second.
Wow, she must have hauled on that to miss that short wall on the inside of four. 130.5, Martini, 131.1. The gap's coming down.
1,600ths of a second there.
Kathleen Martini can't win this, right? From sixth.
Well, this is going to be really close because Sandra is losing a little bit of a speed, only 500ths of a second going into the last curve.
Can she stay in front? 400ths in front. Kathleen Martini cannot win this from six, but she's on the podium, and both German sleds are on the podium. Last week, none. This week, two. Wow. Sandra has no idea what happened there either.
Yeah, but I mean, everybody else on the hill expects Sandra to be in the top. You can see that number three on the front of her sled. That means she has a world rank of number three after last year. So she's used to being at the top and having a lot of success. You can see her having a lot of success coming out of that curve. This one as well, straight down the straightaway after curve 14.
Well, she's an Olympic champion. She's a multiple world champion. She won 8 straight World Cup campaigns. Kathleen Martini celebrates with Sandra Kyriassis. And that's, you don't often see the two of them really beaming together, but after last weekend, I think they're just thrilled to be even with a shout. But what about the gold medal? Kaylee Humphries looking for her fourth in a row. Will Dewdrop Morgan be as good an omen for her as it was for you and Steve Holcomb, Kurt?
Yeah, Kaylee has a 900ths of a second head start going into this heat. And already lengthens it to 1,800ths of a second after that great start, 5:23.
She doesn't have to break start records. She drives up a storm, 85.1, quickest speed we've seen in the entire competition.
Yeah, I can't see any way Kaylee not keeping this lead as she goes down the rest of the track.
Could have said that about Lyndon Rush in the men's race. 131.3, she's going gold, surely.
Straight out of curve 10 into 11.
Lyndon Rush crashed on an epic run to try and take the gold in the two-man race. An ultimate sled to go. She's 3 tenths up. Now she can pretty much sit up and put on the brakes. Big skid there is not going to be enough to damage her. It is the fourth gold medal in a row in World Cup racing. And in between times, of course, she managed to win the World Championship as well. 49.88, winning slide for Kaylee Humphries. New brakewoman, Chelsea Valois. Two World Cup starts, two gold medals. And what a way to remember Dewdrop Morgan, one of the most long-serving of U.S. bobsledders from Lake Placid. Well, memories for John Morgan, our producer and director of his sliding family and his dad. And an emotional day for all.
Kaylee left no doubt in this race. She won both heats by a pretty convincing margin. Pretty great top, kept that speed that she had from that great start. Curve 2, 3. And you saw so many drivers have a problem going into the entrance of 4. Kaylee was nearly perfect.
Well, you know, in the early days of women's bobsledding, you had Françoise Burdette, you had Jean Racine, then you had Sandra Kyriassis. Sandra got in there and started to create a dynasty. And now I'm starting to think, do you know what? We may be out of the Sandra is the benchmark era and very firmly into the Kaylee is the benchmark era. She's still young. She's getting faster with every race. Her consistency is getting better and better. She is such a tough cookie to beat.
Definitely. You know, and Sandra might argue with you. She still, you know, got the silver medal, but Kaylee really putting her foot down and not leaving much room for air.
Plus, she grows a great mustache. You can't argue with that.
I like the handlebar that Chelsea had.
Yeah, very nice. And a great run, two great runs from Kaylee Humphries. You can't do it at one, but you can definitely do it with two. Kaylee Humphries and Chelsea Valois, the new winning combination in women's bobsled. Two races they spent together and two races they have won. Well, my last 9 straight World Cup races on this track have been won by either German or US sleds. They didn't get a 10th. It is Canada who take the gold. And this is her 4th consecutive World Cup race. The first woman to win 4 on the bounce since Sandra Kyriassis in 2007. There you see Kathleen Martini offering her congratulations. We'll be sending our Tim Singer down there in a few moments to speak to our top 3. Confirmation then of Wiesmann World Cup number 2, victory number 2 of the season for Kaylee Humphries and Chelsea Valois. Sandra Kyriassis, Kathleen Martini give Germany something back in this second race weekend of the season. Jamie Grubel just off the podium with Jasmine Fenlater 5th and Christina Hengster slipping to 6th position. Stay with us.
I can hear you. I can hear you.
Kaylee!
If anyone sees Steve Holt, Amanda! We need Steve Holcomb.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Park City, Utah. There you can see the action at the top of the track. That's up just before the start area. All the sleds coming back to be re-prepared for shipping as they head off to Whistler, where we will be racing next weekend. And that will be home ice for our race winner here this evening, Kaylee Humphries, the Canadian. This is her run that took her to her second gold medal this season. Well, Kurt Tomasevich sitting alongside me. You and Steve Holcomb had a good race today in the two-man, and you've got to say that Katie Humphries and Chelsea Valois certainly did in the women's race.
Yeah, it's hard to say too much more than the Kaylee is just dominating the circuit right now. She won last week in Lake Placid. She wins this week here in Park City. And you know she's going to her probably one of her favorite tracks in Whistler, where she won the 2010 Olympic gold medal. So, you know, things are looking good for Kaylee.
Looking good indeed. Looking good, feeling good, supporting Movember. A lot of love going on for the troops there. Well, listen, Katie Humphries, two wins. Hardly a surprise that she leads our World Cup standings. But Sandra Kyriassis, who has 8 World Cup titles in succession, don't forget, follows her. Jasmine Fenlater looking strong, third ahead of Kathleen Martini. All the US sleds in the top 7 positions. Great Britain's Paula Walker in 8th spot. Germans, well, Annie Schneiderhans are down in 10th position. Needs to find a little bit of pace. Well, maybe that will come in Whistler. The Vancouver Games track is a very different nature from this one here at Park City. It's much more like the driver's track of Lake Placid. Well, let's try and catch up then with our top 3 teams. Our man Tim Singer is down there. Tim, what do you got?
And now our flower ceremony, as the flowers are being presented to our third place team, Kathleen Martini and Stephanie Schneider. In second place, Sandra Kyriassis and Francisca Britos and Kaylee Humphries. And Chelsea getting the gold medal. And we'll make our way in for the interviews. First, Kathleen, back on the podium, a good second run.
Yeah, good second run. We're very happy. I found this penny, for the first run, and I think it was a sign, and we had the luck in the second run, and we're happy.
What are you going to buy tonight with that penny?
Oh, I think it will be near to my heart, and there's nothing to buy, I think.
Okay, great job. Third place. Second place. German sled piloted by Sandra Kyriassis. How was this race for you?
Good. Yeah. I'm at the podium, so it was the first run was very good, and the second I had a mistake in 4, and I thought, oh my god, that's it.
But in the bottom, you saw that number 1.
Yeah, I saw number 1, and then super.
Excellent, super indeed. And talking about number 1, Kaylee, you are on a good winning streak here. Talk about first what's on your guys' faces.
Well, we figured if the boys can support Movember, then so can we. So can the girls. So all of the Team Canada girls today decided to rock the mustaches. You can go onto my Twitter or my Facebook account. There's a link, Molympians, and we encourage everybody to please donate for prostate cancer awareness.
Okay, and now let's talk about that winning streak. You have been winning. You've been winning big with different brakemen and on different tracks. How are you doing this?
I don't really know. I just try and do the very best that I can. I'm continuously trying to learn. I've got some great athletes pushing me along the way, really using them for motivation. Chelsea, this is her second World Cup, so we still have a long way to go to be consistent, but every time just keep pointing the sled straight down, push as hard as I can, and hope for the best.
And very quickly, Chelsea, we'll ask you. You're headed to Whistler next week on a track where she won the Olympic gold medal. Your thoughts?
Oh, very excited. My first training run was in Whistler, and it's quite eventful. We did a couple mistakes, but looking forward to it. I think we'll do well.
Yes, indeed. Whistler, quite eventful, and that's next week. It's Canada, Germany, and Germany on the podium. Martin?
Well, Chelsea Valois, a great story. She only turned up in the Canadian program about 6 or 8 weeks ago. She just sent them an email saying, would you be interested? Yeah, actually, they're very interested. She's their number one brake woman. And next week, we go to Whistler. Now, Kurt, you know this track very well. It's fast. It's rough.
It's fast and dangerous. You know, curve 50-50. Curve 13 was a headache for a lot of drivers in the Olympics, and it really hasn't gotten a lot better since then. You know, we had some mistakes last year here. You can see the Korean team. They crashed in curve 5 and went upside down the entire length of the track. And that's nearly a mile of riding on your helmet and shoulders. And you know, I don't want to jinx anybody, but there's a good chance that some of this could happen next week again.
Well, we saw Lyndon Rush crashing in the two-man race, didn't we? You know, you're looking for hundreds of a second, Kurt, and you're putting it out there every single time you get on the ice. Every element of the drive, of the push, of everything is just pushed to the ultimate. And inevitably, occasionally mistakes are made. You put your faith in your driver, and of course, he understands that faith as well.
Yeah.
But it was a good day for the USA here this Friday in Park City. Started with a women's skeleton race. Katie Uhlender coming off a great result. World Championship winner, of course, in February in Lake Placid. And she led after the first heat and consolidated that advantage in what was a very topsy-turvy skeleton race. She managed to find a consistency and she went to gold. Well, Anya Huber finding form again here, but Coach Tuffy Latour was the man with the biggest smile on his face at the end. Well, maybe apart from one athlete, wearing her dad's World Series winner's ring and carrying his name in her sled. And you and Holkey, how did this go? It looked pretty straightforward from where I was sitting.
Yeah, my job only lasted 5 seconds, you know, it was pretty easy, but Holcomb did a great job driving the sled. You know, tiny mistake right there, I guess. I don't know if that should belong in the highlights, but you know, Steve did a fantastic job, and he's been on the track a lot, and it was a pretty good feeling crossing that line.
Yep. Brian Scheimer applauding there. And Steve Holcomb coming in to claim victory in the two-man. That's two on the bounce. The last time that happened was 2007. Well, Holkey hasn't vanished either. He's back down there in the finish area. Tim Singer, tell us a little more.
Well, you know, Martin, since the retirement of Andre Lange following the 2010 Olympics, maybe the greatest bobsled pilot of all time. Well, arguably the best since is the man standing right next to me, USA 1 pilot Stephen Holcomb, an Olympic champion, a three-time world champion, and Stephen, first, talking contemporary, you're on an incredible winning streak with the two-man victories, the world championships last year. Are you feeling like you're driving better than ever?
I think so. You know, I mean, that's quite the intro there. If you compare it to Andre Lange, he's an incredible bobsledder that's won, you know, five or six gold medals. That's incredible. And to be just kind of even considered a part of that group is amazing. And I think right now, you know, everything's kind of coming together. My team's fast. I'm driving well. The sleds are getting faster. It's time for us to step up our game and really put out for Sochi. Looking forward to it.
That's great attitude looking ahead. But I am going to take us back, and I'm going to take us way back here for a second. A lot of people, we don't have the opportunity to tell the Stephen Holcomb story, but you started out right here in Park City, a football player, a skier. Talk a little bit about that experience, and how did it all lead to bobsled?
Honestly, looking back, I don't really know. You know, this is my hometown. I grew up here. I was born and raised, which is one of only a handful of Olympians that have ever come from Utah, and actually from Park City, which is amazing. But yeah, growing up here was a great lifestyle. I mean, I grew up as a ski bum, one of the greatest ski resorts in the country. I ski raced for 10 years, and I thought, you know, my goal was to go to the Olympics as a ski racer. One day there was a tryout for the bobsled team. I thought I would just check it out, see what it was about. Ended up doing well and got invited to a camp. Went to the camp, did well, and then all of a sudden here I am, you know, 15 years later, winning World Cups and winning World Championships and Olympic gold medals. I mean, it's been quite the journey.
And if we can widen out here, Michael, this journey has been accounted recently in a book called But Now See. It's a book that comes out on December 4th, written by Stephen Holcomb. And Stephen, the title, But Now See, I think some people know what it's all about. Why don't you tell us, though?
It is. It's actually But Now I See, which is, you know, I had a degenerative eye disease called keratoconus that I struggled with for a long time. And that's not actually actual size. The book's actually a little smaller than that, so you won't have to turn pages like this. So, but it's a story that a lot of people knew from the Olympics. You know, I overcame this eye disease to go and win a gold medal, and that's, and it was a great story in itself, but there's a lot more to the story. There's a lot more detail than people understand to the story. And I think, I told everything there was to know about how I went from going blind to being on top of the world.
And if they didn't take care of that surgery successfully, you would have had to have a book this big, right?
Exactly. I was losing my vision pretty quickly. When I had the surgery, my vision was actually 21,000, and I couldn't legally drive a car. I mean, legally blind is 2,200, so It was pretty scary. Nobody really knew. I kept it a secret for a long time. And that was kind of the hard part, is when all of a sudden my vision became a hindrance. And if we ended up hurting ourselves or hurting another athlete, or even, you know, worse, killing an athlete because I couldn't see and it came out that I was blind, it would have been just devastating to me. So I ended up basically telling the coaches I was going to retire. And they said, well, let's find a way to cure this. And we ended up finding an experimental procedure that changed everything.
Steven, irony and a success story. As a man who hardly could see is now one of the finest bobsled pilots in the world. Again, the book is called But Now I See. The foreword by Jeff Bodine, the builder of the Olympic Championship sled, and this Night Train motivated book will be for sale starting December 4th. You can find it at Barnes & Noble and Amazon. Thanks so much, Steve. Good luck the rest of the way.
Great. Thank you very much. Appreciate
All right, Martin Haven, back to you.
Well, thank you, Steve. Thank you, Tim. Yeah, I was in the shop at the museum when we arrived here, and I was wandering around on Wednesday. I said, oh, I didn't know Hulk had written a book, so I picked it up and bought it, and I was talking to him Thursday. I said, I didn't know he'd written a book. He said, I didn't know it was out yet either. It was that fresh off the presses. It's here at the track before anywhere else. And, yeah, an inspiring story. And Kurt, you know, every Olympic athlete has had to battle through all kinds of physical and mental adversity, because for all the highs, they've got to be a lot of lows as well.
Yeah, definitely. In our sport, because it's a team sport, you know, we all go through each other's highs and lows as well. You know, Holcomb was, you know, battling this part of his life, and, you know, we did what we could to try to help him, but, you know, there's not a lot I can do to help him with an eye disease except be there for him and be a friend. And, you know, in the end, it really turned out well.
It certainly did, and continues to turn out well. Victor Day in the two-man and a stint in the booth. Boy, we're working you hard. You're earning your dinner tonight. So we're looking now towards tomorrow's action. Again, a lot of action to get through. We've got the four-man bobsled competition. Again, Steve and the Night Train will be in action. You sliding tomorrow too?
Absolutely.
Wow. That's triple bubble. That's a lot to get through as well. And, of course, you've got the men's skeleton race coming up tomorrow morning as well. Martins Dukors of Latvia, now he's been the benchmark for the last couple of seasons, has won by seconds. Last weekend, he won by a couple of hundredths. Are we in for a few more upsets tomorrow? I think Park City has put on a good show so far. I think we've got a lot more to come. Kaylee Humphries has just won our women's bobsleigh race. Two wins today for the USA. Katie Ulender claiming the skeleton, and Steve Holcomb, the two-man bobsleigh gold. Well, it's been a great day for North America, dominating the podium here. Join us for all the action tomorrow from Park City, Utah. Until then, my thanks to you and to Kurt Tomasevich. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye for now.